Good morning. It is now the proper weekend. I'm back on the bike indoors, as you can see, because it is frosty outside, so no chance of repeating yesterday's adventures. My legs feel like bricks, but we're doing some zone 2 riding, so endurance work for a couple of hours. Got the chat going as well, some friends just to keep me entertained. It's going to be a bit of a slog, this one, but after I've done this, we got a run to do. Endurance run today, double endurance day. Love it.
How feeling?
Yeah, okay. These kind of workouts kind of suck. I don't have hands anymore, I have claws. So cold. Alright, I'm all changed, stretched, whatnot. We're gonna pop out because Alex is doing some intervals on her run just outside. Brought some bonus clips because I'm not the only athlete in the house. Let's get arty with this. Ooh, looks like she's working quite hard. I'm going back inside. I might have a cookie. Snacks. Time for walkies. Walkies. We are gonna go get some coffee because we're running low.
I have to go to the post office.
And Alex needs to go to the post office. So we're killing two birds with one stone. So I thought we should talk a bit about routines and motivation for training because that's something that everyone struggles with a lot of the time. We found that being in a routine really helps. So it just means you know what you're coming up against.
Yeah, it kind of takes the decision out of it a little bit so you don't have to kind of psych yourself into something or spend time choosing a workout. It's just kind of set for you, so it takes away that first kind of what am I doing element. But I think regardless of if you have a routine, sometimes the motivation still isn't really there.
Willpower is not a like an unlimited source. You can't just rely on it constantly. You have to be in the right mindset, well rested, and give yourself a chance basically. And if you find that you're really struggling day after day, week after week, you probably need to change something.
Yeah, because at the end of the day, if you're not enjoying the training that you're doing, you're not going to stick to it. Whatever
exactly.
The routine is, and the motivation will still not be there.
Our takeaway lunch did not last very long.
No. He made it that far.
Yeah. Just far enough away to eat. Okay, session number 2 today. We are going to do a run about an hour long. Same as on the bike, we're going to be working in zone 2 for the endurance benefit side of things. Again, not taking too much out of the legs, not building too much fatigue, so I can still do a good workout tomorrow, but still getting some good gains with my cardio fitness, which will really help me in the car. And yeah, just give me more headspace and capacity to work while I'm under stressed conditions. It is cold, so I am stealing Alex's gloves, featuring a hole. You're not using them.
I might want them.
Yeah. So, all done. So, it's just under an hour, which was pretty much what was prescribed, 11 and a bit K. Average heart rate, 141. That's pretty much spot on for me. Don't need to go any harder than that to get the effect that we want. Apparently, I need 19 hours to recover from that. Lol, that's not going to happen. Yeah, that's our recovery drink today.
It's not alcoholic.
I mean, it's something. Good morning. It's Sunday, the final day of workouts this week before my rest day. Just getting my drink ready. It's got some sugar and carbs in it because I'm getting back on the bike this morning for another indoor session. It's a double day today again. So we're going to Williams this evening for some gym work. Feeling quite tired now. Woke up and the legs were quite heavy. It is that time of the week where we're doing quite a lot. But rest day is tomorrow, so it's last little push. So on the menu today, we have some tempo efforts, which is like just a bit above endurance pace. And then we're going to inject some harder efforts in there, shorter, more spicy pacing. And then we're going to finish after we've done those sort of up-down, going from tempo up to VO2, back down, just doing that constantly. Going to have a little rest and do some threshold work, sustained threshold, which is just teaching your body to deal with lactate. It's a quite a hard session today. Alright, all done. So this portion was a bit of free riding, riding with some of the team that I'm racing with again next Tuesday. Some harder efforts, especially towards the end here. Actually got my peak heart rate of the session there. Cool. And apparently it's an epic ride. We'll take that. Good session. Yeah, sorted. I can't feel my toes. Because it's cold. Alright, slight change of plan. Now I'm going to join Alex, who's going for a nice easy run. She's going to do 10k. I'm not going to do 10k because that's too much and it wasn't part of the plan. But I'll join her for a few k and then turn back home. Shake out the legs after that hard ride and we'll still hopefully be ready for gym tonight. It might be snowing. The sooner we run, the warmer we'll be. All right, let's do it. Oh, it's cold. It's fresh. It's very, very fresh. So cold. So cold. But very, very cold. Okay, I've turned around now. Yeah, I can't speak because my mouth is cold. But Alex has gone on. I'm going back home, have some food, warm up.
Controversial if it's like a small if it was like a small kind of like coming together where it's definitely
all right guys, so it is rest day, thank God for that. my legs are destroyed, and my upper body's feeling it a bit as well. So definitely thankful for that. I slept very well last night. But today, I thought we'd take the opportunity to go over some of the stats from the week and a bit of a summary of my training program and where that leaves us. So across the week, looking at the three main disciplines that I train in, so gym for strength work, running and riding, I did just under 17 hours of work. On the bike, that was about 307 kilometers of riding. That was just under 10 hours. So a decent chunk of that that whole training block. I ran for 2 hours, just over, and I did 4.5 hours of strength work. So the reason that it's biased particularly towards these two and cardio is because that's generally what the car calls for. We're in the car for an hour or 2 hours at a time. In the case of Formula One, endurance races, it's even more. And your heart rate is working quite hard, so it really pays to be efficient, like I spoke about on the run. Strength work is important, and that's why I still do it, but it's more, a lot of it is for injury prevention. So making sure that my muscles are well developed and that I've got good stability through my body and everything's healthy, basically. There are a few areas that are a little bit different. Your neck, for example, particularly with F1 and single seaters, you need to do specific neck training, like what I've shown you guys. And grip strength is another important one for holding the wheel. Some cars are power steering, Formula One does, but other cars, such as in Formula 2, don't, and it then becomes quite important. So another thing that I wanted to look at with you guys was the data that I collect from this, which is my Whoop band. I find it quite useful for some things, less useful for others, and we're gonna just dive into that now. Basically, it's a wearable. I've got it on my wrist, and it measures my heart rate continuously 24/7, and it spits out a lot of data. The main numbers it comes out with are this number, which is your recovery. That happens every morning, and it tells you basically how much strain your body is able to take on and how tired you are, what's going on with your body. Your strain number, that's out of 21. Don't ask me why it's 21, but it's just to tell you how hard you've worked for that day. And then it also gives you your sleep metrics as well, how much sleep it thinks you need versus how much you actually got. So quite a lot of data. Looking at this, this is the week as we've just had it. So starting on Monday, where it was my rest day, and you can see that the strain is the lowest that it's going to be for the whole week. And after that, it's right up there. And this is something called a logarithmic scale, which means that it's not a linear number going from 0 to 21. The closer you are to 21, the harder it is, and it's impossible to actually get 21 out of 21. So you can see here the strain. We have the one day over here, which is moderate, which was my recovery day. And then after that, it's either strenuous or all-out efforts. And that's the kind of strain that you have to put on your body to actually get benefits and adaptation. The more interesting number is recovery, and that's this line with the green and yellow dots, which fluctuates quite a bit. At the start of the week, you can actually see on my rest day, it's not great, but that can be a bit of a hangover from the previous few days' work when I was working on the weekend. And after the rest day, it bounces right up, and it's at, what are we at, 88%, and even the day after, 90%, even after a really hard day on Tuesday. And that's just showing that my body is in a really good place. It's in good condition. I'm not really carrying a lot of fatigue, and your heart rate is really responsive. After the first 2 days of the training week, though, we can see it kind of crashes because I had two very hard days. If you remember, with you had a core workout and a Zwift all-out race in Tuesday, and then the time trial running on Wednesday, which is really hard as well. So we go all the way down to 46, which is about as low as I ever see my numbers, because everyone's a bit different. And it stays there through Thursday, Friday. We bounce back up on Saturday a little bit, because Friday was a slightly easier day, but it then crashes again on Sunday. So, you know, these numbers are quite a useful guide. Certainly in the early part of the week, this matches how I felt really well. Feeling pretty tired on my rest day, like I am today, and then feeling pretty good at the start of the week. And then as you get further into the week, you see more and more of this where your body is struggling. Another thing, like I said, it measures is the sleep side of things. So we've got two axes, one for sleep performance, which is basically how much sleep you got, more or less, and then sleep consistency. And this is to do with the time of day that you're going to bed and waking up. And the more consistent you are with that, the better your sleep is supposed to be. So that's what that is for. And we can see I do pretty well around getting optimal sleep, but it's cool to have that more just to motivate yourself to not spend hours scrolling on TikTok. And then another interesting graph that we've got from this week just gone is my recovery. You can see it says your recovery compared to men aged 19 to 26 is about 11% higher than average. And I wanted to throw that one up just because it's to show that even though I'm working quite hard, I do try and make sure that recovery score stays high, because if you train when you're tired and when that recovery score is down here in the red and the yellow zones, you're not going to get as much work out of your body. You're not going to get the benefit from those training sessions. You probably won't complete them. So it is important to stay in decent shape. And just a final thought on Whoop. I think it's really useful. It's great because every morning it gives me metrics that I really trust, like my resting heart rate and my heart rate variability. But the algorithm that Whoop uses to spit out a golden number at the end of that and say, you're 90% recovered today, you'll have to take that with a grain of salt, because I know that my heart rate variability isn't exactly conventional sometimes, and that can throw off the reading. So you have to know your body and you know, have a bit of trial and error with stuff like this. Anyone, it's not just Whoop. I've tried lots of different bands and wearables, and they're all, you know, a little bit flawed in that sense. So it's just understanding from your own experiences when to listen to those numbers and when to ignore them. I thought I would finish with just some general advice for people who are training themselves, both just starting out and at a higher level. Number one, you cannot beat having crappy sleep and poor diet. It's not going to make you fit by itself by any means. You need to put the work in. But if you have really bad sleep and if you have poor diet, it's going to hold you back. Number two, if you are limited on time, like so many people are these days, just focus on consistency. You're much better off doing even just 15 minutes every day or most days than trying to aim for doing an hour session or going to the gym and doing an hour and a half once or twice a week. You will get much better results being consistent and doing a little bit every day and varying what you're doing every day. And speaking of volume, if you are lucky enough like me to have time to train more, just be careful. And as you increase your volume to the kind of volume that I'm doing 6 days a week, you have to make sure that the quality of your sessions is better. You have to be smart with how you use your energy and not go all out every day. Finally, just at higher levels, I would say, of training in any sport, you should definitely take in other sports, if nothing else, for your sanity. I know that I like to try different stuff and enjoy different sports, but you'll get something different and your body will learn to have a little bit more breadth than just focusing on a really narrow band of fitness. And that really increases your resilience to injuries and so on. Yeah, those are my tips. I hope you guys enjoyed. We tried to put across as much as we could this week, not least with the help of
a certain someone. Thank you for filming things.
It's okay. If you have any questions, leave them in the comments. I will do my best to answer them. And in the meantime, we're going to go do some yoga because it's rest day. And peace.
Through the back of your body. Shitballs.